the Vox Markets podcast with Justin Waite. Nothing in this podcast is intended as investment advice, and the people in this podcast may hold positions in the stocks they talk about. Do not buy anything based solely on a tip or recommendation. Please do your own research.
Welcome to the podcast on Friday, the 9th of April, 2021. On the podcast today, Jason Tebb, new CEO of OnTheMarket, discusses his plans and vision for the online property portal. Plus, full-time investor and equity analyst Paul Hill gives his view on the market and talks about stocks to follow, plus some of the stocks that he likes that he thinks he's going to rock it. We have a joke about that. But stocks mentioned include SourceBio, Avacta, Oncimmune, Verici DX, Polarean Imaging, Equals, Gfinity, OnTheMarket, Eleco, Rosslyn Data, and Sage. By the way, I do talk about COVID testing stocks, and I say I'm a bit down on some of them, but I mean, not on the ones we talk about. And I refer to the microcaps who just release RNSs with COVID-19 testing in the titles just to get the share price up. You know, I'm not the ones I'm talking about there, but I just want to make that clear. Okay, also on the podcast, at the end of the podcast, I have two lists for you, the top five most followed companies on Vox Markets in the last 24 hours, and the top five most read RNSs. You can check these lists out at voxmarkets.co.uk. We see lots of other content. In fact, Oxford Biodynamics is an article there on those. There's one on Vesarian. There's one on Open Orphan. Good rise today. Alba Mineral Resources. And, of course, COVID-19 Index. Let's check that out. Biggest fall of the day. In fact, it's Novacyt, down 31%. They just announced apparently one of their testing contracts is not going to be renewed with the NHS. And it's a surprise. And biggest rise of the day is Your Gene Health, 11.86% up at 16.5. Novacyt is down 31% at 4.75, by the way. Check out that and all the content at voxmarkets.co.uk.
Vox Markets is an online community of investors that runs a free mobile and desktop platform that allows you to track news and updates about any UK-listed company, offering RNS push notifications, detailed charts, pricing data, and much more. Find out more at voxmarkets.co.uk/app.
And joining me on the podcast right now is Jason Tebb, CEO of OnTheMarket. Jason, thanks for joining me.
Pleasure. Good morning, Justin.
Yeah, and for people not familiar, OTMP is ticker, of course. A lot of people have been saying, when's the new guy coming on? Jason, the new guy, when is he going on? I've said, apparently he wants to start off, get some initiatives out of the way, get a bit of, get his feet under the desk first, but he's coming on. But just glad you come on and explain your vision for OnTheMarket. But before we start into that, there's always some people listening who may not be familiar with OnTheMarket. So can you explain what OnTheMarket is, please, Jason?
Of course I can. So onthemarket.com is a property marketplace, which is sometimes referred to as a property portal. And that's where estate agents, letting agents and house builders advertise their available properties across the country. And then we introduce them to consumers who visit the site to search for those properties of interest and engage directly with those advertisers.
Yeah. Okay. So first 100 days pretty much in the office there. So can you give us a brief background on yourself there and what attracted you to the role here?
Of course. So I've been in the property sector for just over two decades. The vast majority of that time has been as an estate agent working at some of the biggest brands in the UK. And then later on in my career, working in property finance, funding and development. And I suppose that gives me an experience from a customer perspective in terms of being an ex-estate agent and an ex-house builder, effectively. And I'm old enough to remember working as an agent when people still went into all of the offices up and down the high street on a Saturday, mm-hmm. and have seen probably at first hand the growth of property technology, prop tech as it's known, and how that can benefit both consumers and agents. And I also saw the OnTheMarket business launch and scale from a very different perspective, as I was one of their customers at the time. And I think that gives me an insight into what they really think and feel about the business. So I suppose when I was approached about the role, I saw the huge potential and the opportunity to differentiate the brand from others in the space. And the more I talked to the senior management team, the more encouraged I was about the current position, but more importantly, where it could develop in the future. So I suppose simple answer, Justin, is I see huge potential for growth. And that's why I took the role.
Yeah. Well, in fact, tell us, what are the, since you got in there, some of the positives you've found since joining?
Well, I've been hugely encouraged by what I've seen, and the business has got some really strong foundations. We're averaging over 25 million consumer visitors to the site every single month. We're in a strong cash position, stronger than at this time last year. And that's despite, you know, the unprecedented economic and health-related headwinds that COVID presented. And we've got increasing revenue. At the time of our last trading update, we're expecting revenues to be around 23 million. That's up from 18.8 in the year before. But we were still offering discounts during that time through the COVID pandemic to our agents. So, you know, you combine that with the fact that average leads are up year on year, and we've got an experienced management team, and consumer awareness is up 10% year on year. I think that there's some real positives, and the business is in a really stable place and then perfectly positioned, therefore, for growth and development into the next stage.
Yeah, well, do you know what? A couple of people asked me, you know, said, what's happening with the share price? Is grinding a bit lower? And I said, well, you can't do much about the share price. You know, all you can do is look at the business. And the last set of figures we had, you were growing very well, like I said, despite COVID, and even, you know, Rightmove didn't grow last year. And so against that backdrop, you're growing. So what, you know, are the key advantages now to continuing that growth, to be successful in a sort of busy marketplace? I've heard people mentioning, you know, other sort of sites like Booming or Propositions, and obviously Rightmove's out there, Zoopla. So, you know, what do you need to do to continue that growth and continue to be successful then, Jason?
Sure. So I think every business and any business in this space and others should always be looking up, sideways and down, and learning from competitors, new and old. There's always going to be new entrants to any market, and we actually welcome that competition, because I think that more competition benefits agents and house builders. So we welcome that, and we always look very closely at those competitors when they come along. I think if you look at the key advantages of On the Market, we now have a core fundamental aspect of our business, which is the property listing part of the business, that is both stable and self-sufficient and is growing organically. And that really gives us a fantastic platform to now look at other areas. I think also one of the advantages is that we have a very loyal customer base. As you know, we're 65% agent owned, and therefore our aims and objectives are aligned perfectly. And that gives an advantage in terms of where we develop our product and offering and our future development, as it's always going to be focused on our estate agent and house builder customers as well as our consumers. And we've got the opportunity now to develop our own elements of differentiation to provide those services throughout the entire property life cycle, not just at the point of transaction. So I think they're the main advantages.
Yeah, yeah. And I know you've been sort of, you know, getting in touch with lots of agents, asking for their feedback and consumers, and you're putting the agents and consumers first. And so does that shape the future? And what does the sort of future look like for On the Market?
Well, you're right, Justin. I carried out some virtual town halls since joining the business to engage with agents, with house builders, but also with our consumers. If I'm frank, I was expecting a few agents to turn up, but I've literally spoken to hundreds and hundreds of agents on these calls now. And I've been really impressed by their support, their views. They've got very strong views about the future of the business, their ideas, their suggestions. So I suppose having a business where our customers are so supportive and want us to grow has been really great for me. And that really has helped to shape my vision for the future of the business in the medium and long term.
Yeah. And can you, before we go into three reasons, I mean, you recently, the last bit of news you announced was the acquisition of Glandier Techlet. Can you explain to people what's that about and why it will help the business, Jason?
Well, I think what the Glandier and Techlet deal provides is the first step towards my future vision for the business. And I believe that the future of On the Market is more than just a property portal, more than just a property platform. And we are going to be developing our product and service offering to benefit and drive engagement with agents, house builders, but most importantly, to the consumer, and aim to deliver best-in-class products and platforms across that entire property journey, not just at point of transaction. And we're focusing really in the medium to long term in four key areas. The first one is the portal, which of course, OTM.com, everything will be centered around. And we're going to be carrying out a bit of a brand refresh and repositioning using the consumer research and the estate agent research, asking what they need and want from us and developing our brand accordingly. The second one, as you rightly mentioned, Justin, is the Glanty option. And that's around our software proposition. And so obviously subject to due diligence, when we complete on that acquisition, we will have the benefit of a software house whose sole purpose is to develop products and functionality for estate agents, house builders, and therefore our consumers too, which I think is a fantastic step forward in terms of the way we will be developing our business in the future. And I think also we're looking at data and market intelligence, how we can incorporate data and more market intel to the benefit of our agents. And we're currently working on some commercial partnerships with a large data provider to provide that information to agents and consumers, which is what both of those parties are telling us that they want and they need. And if you look at government legislation, you look at the MHCLG white paper that's been on the table for about a year, there's a movement towards an increased level of transparency in the transaction process. And I think using the tools that we have and the tools that we'll be building, we can help facilitate that to benefit agents and consumers. And I suppose the last thing really is on communications. And there's no doubt about it, the COVID pandemic has changed the way people perceive virtual communications versus face-to-face communications. And indeed, some consumers are now telling me that they would prefer virtual first viewing rather than physical first viewing. And I have to tread a fine line because I want to increase engagement opportunities between agents, house builders and consumers rather than reduce them. So I'm looking very carefully at how we can use communications and marketing tools to increase those levels of engagement between those parties.
Excellent stuff. Okay, Jason, every day on the podcast, I highlight the top five most followed companies. To get in that list, of course, people have to hit that follow button and add you to their watch list. So if you could, in summary, maybe three bullet points as to why someone should hit that follow button and add On The Market to their watch list, please.
Sure. So I would certainly urge people to hit that follow button because we have strong growth in both the key metrics that I mentioned earlier and in our financial position. Not only are we seeing growing consumer awareness and visitor numbers, but we're in a better cash position year on year and have increasing revenues, which means we can now invest in people and products, but all within a framework of prudent cost management. The second thing is I think we've started an exciting new phase of our growth. We've got a really ambitious roadmap. I'm massively passionate about that roadmap and believe in it. And I think we can see On The Market become more than just a property portal with a suite of new products and services, many of which will be revenue generating. We'll combine to grow income from existing customer base as well as help onboard new agents to the platform, but also being committed to sustainably fair pricing for our customers, which is our agents and house builders. And I think the third thing is we have a different proposition. We have a differentiated proposition offering from other business in this vertical. We focus on new and exclusive properties that are either listed 24 hours or more before right move or Zoopla, or indeed aren't available on any other property search sites at all. And we're now developing even further those areas of differentiation to give serious property seekers an advantage in their property search.
Marvellous stuff. Jason, it's good to chat to you. Hopefully we'll catch up in the not-too-distant future. Thank you very much.
And to you. Thanks, Justin.
The Vox Markets Podcast with Justin Waite.
And joining me on the podcast right now and live on video on screen, you can catch us out on YouTube, it's Paul Hill, equity analyst, full-time of everything. Just check with Paul's sleep pattern. I'm a bit worried about you, Paul. Your sleep. It's like you seem to go to bed almost like just after 6 o'clock news in the evening, and you wake up before midnight, and then you research and do everything. What is going on? What is your routine? Did you have a decent sleep?
Unfortunately, Justin, I've got some bad news. I had a decent night's sleep, which is probably why I gave you a lot of abuse before we got on here. But Wednesday night, I did only slept for a couple of hours. I got up about 11:30 at night. And then worked all the way through, which was a bit of a stretch, but such is life. But no, having had one day of no sleep, then or work 24 hours, then last night I've got a full 8 hours. So it's bad luck for you.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Can I suggest you maybe if you wake up before midnight, you go back to bed?
I sometimes just cannot sleep. It's sort of like whatever reason. It's sort of like my head's just spinning, and so I get on.
Is that what's spinning with? Do you know, I have the same thing. When I've got an investment in my head, I'm thinking about something, or I think, oh, I say that's a good idea. You know, something just drops, and you realize, oh, I better look that up. I better check that out. And then you can't stop thinking about it then. And then you go, I had that a lot of time. Once you get that in your head, especially with investing, If you've got something in your head, trying to think about different metrics, maybe, or, oh, it's worth researching that, actually, finding out that. And I looked that up. But you can't wait until the morning. You've got to just get up after an hour of thinking about it. You just get up, which is annoying. I have two notes this week. My son's got up we're getting into stocks in a bit, but he's got up with a bad dream, and he comes in and says, "I'm not joking. I've had a really bad dream." I thought, I'm glad you're not joking. It's 3 a.m. Then he goes straight back to bed, sleeps straight away. Kids sleep excellently. And then I just get up at 3 anyway. I think, God, this is annoying. So I've had two nights of that this week. But
you know what keeps me awake at night?
Yeah,
it's,
what?
It's discovering new functionalities on Excel.
Yeah. Oh, I'll try that formula. That's a good chat.
Exactly.
Yes. I've discovered a way to hide the div, the formula side.
Exactly. But sort more data out.
Yeah. Yes, marvelous stuff. So, have you seen actually? I tweeted it today, and it's got, in fact, I'm going to screen share because it's very important here. This, I think, I go to Twitter and I shared this, and I thought it was a very big metric. In fact, there's two sort of big things, big news. We shared both the same thing on Twitter, plus there's something else. So this one here, Britain should reach herd immunity against COVID-19 on Monday. I thought, that's good timing. That's spot on for the first lockdown easing. But this is from, they've modelled it. It's a real-time modelling from the university, I think University College London somewhere, one of the top ones. But they're saying that once you hit 73.4% of people either contract the virus through vaccinations, previous infections, or natural immunity, you get that where there's less opportunity for it to spread, of course. And so hospitalizations won't be as much anyway. So that's very good, I thought.
You raise a very good point there. I mean, that is absolutely about right in when you calculate out the the transmission rates for COVID for the current variants and with the vaccinations. And what that means is once you reach herd immunity, the natural R decreases. It goes below one, even if everybody was freely moving around. And therefore, you still get obviously people with COVID, but it'll actually the number of incidents and infections on that sort of base case will decrease. And everybody then thinks, fabulous, we've got the back of COVID. The problem you have is if you then put in a new variant into that mix.
That word variant's been everywhere, isn't it? Variant.
Exactly. Oh, variant. But what that means for investors is such that you then unfortunately reduced the herd immunity significantly because you have a new lot of population who can then contract it again. And that was coincides perfectly with the news overnight, the big news overnight from the government.
But hang on a second. Let me just say one thing before you say that. Pfizer and Moderna now, actually, I think it's Pfizer, said their vaccine is pretty much effective, especially because serious illness. And that's the problem. Serious illness is the big problem. When you talk about an economy, I'm not talking about, sadly, the health side of it, but I mean, talking from an economy perspective, when you get the beds filling up in hospitals, that's the problem where you have to lock down, of course, because you can't have that overspilling, paralysing NHS, because even normal sort of surgery gets put off and postponed. So even with the variants, new variants, Pfizer are saying their vaccine, I don't know if you saw the figures, very high. It's even very effective against,
Yeah, but it's those known variants. I mean, let's be clear about it.
It's like a flu, isn't it?
There's a P1 variant doing the rounds in Brazil, and there's 4,000 people dying each day off the back of it. Now, the point we're going to get.
But also, their vaccinations are not as high as anywhere else.
Yeah, I know, but we're going to get sort of new mutations. I think for investors, we've just got to assume, given this is highly a mutatious disease, we're going to get new variants that are going to reduce the efficacy of the actual vaccines.
The current ones. This is what I'm saying, though. And I believe this. I think right now, we live in fear because it's unknown, okay? But I think we'll discover most of the variants, will be taken down by the current vaccinations. There'll be iterations of these anyway. And you get the herd immunity, all that together. Plus, you've got testing and all this stuff going on. I don't mean we're over the big worry here.
We're over the big worry. But again, I keep banging the table on this one, and this is what the government are doing itself, is such that it's very worried that we're going to get new variants because we don't know what's coming down the track in terms of new variants. And they're actually going to spread like wildfire through the population.
That's the worry. It's not the
realistic. Exactly. And so that's why this is the big news from overnight. The government have said, yes, we can all go on holiday, but we're going to have agreed...
That's it there. See that tweet there? That's what I'm saying. Second tweet.
Okay,
that's coincidental. That's what I was saying about the two tweets today. You shared that from the BBC. I do five things podcast in the morning, and that was number one, the green light traffic system. Yeah. The traffic light system and coronavirus testing, where PCR tests are going to come in. And they're saying now, it's unfair on families who can just about afford a holiday, because it'll cost them at least £100 a head each to do the PCR test.
Yeah. But let's be clear about it. Most people have been saving money over the last year and they want a holiday. They're just going to basically put it all into the holiday cost. Now, there's two things which come out of it. First, I think one of us is going to be speaking to Jay LeCue, the CEO or the exec chairman of SourceBio next week when it puts its prelims out on Tuesday. That is one of the biggest PCR testing companies in the, you know, in the country, as you know. This is going to be like a put a rocket booster under there. Under their testing in the UK. And it was just a coincidental that the shares ticked up last night. So, I mean, I think this is going to be, could potentially be huge for them. Okay. So what you've got, if people want to go on holiday, they're going to need PCR testing. And I think a lot of people are basically just going to put it into the price. What's also equally really interesting is that what's happening with all the cruise operators. Now, the international cruise operators have said, right, okay, UK is doing really, really well. Let's move a shed load of our fleet over to the UK and offer staycations to people who want a holiday in the UK or around the UK, but can't get any. There's no availability in Devon, Cornwall, the Lake District, all the popular hotspots. And so consequently, what you're going to have is that there's going to be a shed load of people who are going to go onto cruise ships because they can holiday around the UK for a nice little jolly. And to get onto a cruise ship, I'm almost certain, just for peace of mind of passengers, you're going to be required a PCR testing. So I know you've been dissing this for some time. PCR testing.
I ain't been dissing it, man. I ain't been dissing it.
Testing is
going to be... All I'm saying is this. I think if you look at the figures, in fact, do you know, I want to share something else with you here, right? If you look at the figures and the drop-off, right? Look at this, it's ridiculous. Look at that drop-off here. This is healthcare, this is beds taken up by the NHS, right? Massive drop-off, this is vaccination, not just lockdown. Because your lockdown was here, and it's a lot more gradual. This is lockdown plus vaccination, the drop-off. And I think, you know, of course, SourceBio is not their only thing. They're testing, of course, it's an area of their business. All I've ever said is be wary of companies that rely solely on testing who haven't got a commercial contract as yet, because they're playing the slow game here. They're playing catch up. And we don't know how long, of course, the contracts are out there. We don't know how long this testing is going to be effective.
I was pulling your leg, Justin.
Yeah, but
sorry,
do you know what I'm saying?
I understand.
I genuinely think when we get that tipping point, like you say, where you get herd immunity and all that stuff and vaccinations kicking in, I think the landscape will change very quickly as to when we won't require so much testing.
Yeah.
And I think it'll change very quickly. Right now, you think we're going to need lots of testing, but even people going on holidays, how big a market is that? It's the UK at the moment, but how quickly will that market reduce in size? So what I'm saying is, if you're in a company that only does testing and as yet hasn't got a massive commercial contract, and you've got all your money in that, that's very high risk, because we don't know how fast that market will reduce.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of competition in that market already. If you're not in there getting commercial contracts, which SourceBio are and Novacyte are, those kind of companies are getting those commercial contracts already. If your company's in there, they haven't got a commercial contract and they're hoping to get one in the future, how long is this market around for? You know, I don't know.
Okay. So you're not only going to have people traveling in turn, tourists and stuff, but you're also going to get the business community coming back. And a really good, interesting data point this week, and we've seen this movie before, is if you actually do a bit of research on Las Vegas and forget about gambling, it is absolutely rammed. It's the hotel capital of the world, and you cannot get a room simply because of conferences, exhibitions, trade shows, because people want to see their customers, the sales guys want to see the customers. So this summer, you're going to get two big dollops of demand for PCR testing. You're going to get tourists who are going to say, look, I want a holiday, I'm going abroad, I'm going to pay for the PCR test. And alternatively, you're going to get a lot of business people who are going to say, I haven't seen my customer for 12 months, I'm going to go and see them, and I'm going to go for PCR testing. They're just going to roll it straight into the price. So this summer, this year, until the world catches up with the UK and we really get a grip on all the variants, then we're going to have these testing at the borders. There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, I agree, but again, like I said, you know, we've gone from how long have we been vaccinating for now? 6 months in the UK?
Yeah.
And we're pretty much done. We're hitting herd immunity, pretty much, you know. And so you can, if everyone else gets up to speed, another 6 months maybe. So what I'm saying is, when you're an investor, you should always look at companies, you know, if you're a long-term investor, of course, you want transparency and forward guidance for a couple of years, hopefully, or you think, you know, you reasonably think, okay, these cash flows the next 3 to 5 years, maybe. Now, if you're a company in the testing field only, and that's all you got, and I'm not talking about SourceBio and Oversight, because they're making money elsewhere as well, and they've already got big contracts. I'm talking about you're only in that, and they're trying to get a bit of a share of the market. How long is that share going to be there for? You know,
I get your point. I totally do. We're at a bit of a sort of like a peak part of the testing. However, what I would say is that I am absolutely in the camp that on an ongoing basis, we have just created an industry.
Yeah, no, I agree. Testing, which is going to require,
and it's billions and billions of pounds.
Oh yeah, but what I'm saying is, it's not as big an opportunity as the COVID testing, which we just had. I mean, that gave an opportunity to so many companies to get into that space. But sooner or later, that will be reducing that market.
It will be, but it will probably go to a third of what it currently is at its peak, and that's Boston Consulting Group. And a third of its peak is still tens of billions of dollars worldwide of new testing that was zero before the pandemic will continue going forward. Now, just continuing that theme, okay, I've had a lot of questions on social media for pretty serious investors and from sort of like, you know, basically your mom and pop investors asking about Avacta's lateral flow test. Now, What I would say here, we've had some big news last week in terms of they had a contract with Abcam. But I'm just going to reference this. I have absolutely got no insider information. This is totally my own view. And this is, you know, to put
I'm
a
glad
caveat.
You haven't.
Exactly. Yeah. No. Exactly. Yeah. I haven't even spoken to the guys. Okay. But my view. Okay. Because the company's indicated that they're expecting the results from their final clinical trial results from their lateral flow test and the CE mark, you know, sort of like imminently. Now, what has actually led to a week's delay? And that's what investors have been asking me about, and they're getting nervous. And all I would say is that putting my experience and my investor hat on and my knowledge of the industry, there's two things that are coming up all the time. One, the authorities are flipping slow at the moment to approve anything. And the reason is they haven't got enough resource. The FDA in the States is taking ages to approve even emergency measures. So I would personally say, just don't even think about sort of like, you know, if there's any issue, because I really don't think there is. And the second thing, which could potentially be a delay, is such that because the UK has been so good at vaccinating, the number of people who have been infected, you know, become infected, has actually decreased rapidly. And that may have actually slowed up originally the completion of their test, just to get enough people to actually test. So it could be for absolute, it probably is for absolute sort of like genuine reasons. And the other thing why, this is my personal view, yeah, and this is the big news. They had a contract with, they basically got an ELISA research contract for their COVID reagent chemistry and panel with Abcam. And Abcam's over £4 billion business, okay? These guys are one of the world's leaders for this type of research into infectious diseases. What that tells me, it's a massive endorsement of Avacta's chemistry, COVID reagent chemistry, which says it works. It absolutely works. And they said it's like, you know, I think the CEO, Alistair Smith, mentioned that it was, in his mind, it was the most accurate. So we've got the chemistry from Avacta, in my view, as an investor, and I don't know, works perfectly. It really is top notch. Otherwise, Abcam wouldn't have adopted it, okay, for its ELISA test for the research. Now, the only other thing which potentially is that it's on a manufacturing, you know, sort of there's a manufacturing delay. Now, the main manufacturer is MoLogic, yeah? Now, MoLogic is actually, again, it's a private company, really big. It makes Clear Blue, you know, basically the pregnancy test. It's got CE marking. And my view is such that it can do this on the back of its hand. It really is not a problem on sort of manufacturing it. So I think the chemistry is fine. The manufacturing process is absolutely fine. And the likely reason for the 7 or 8 day delay, because that's what I've been getting a lot of sort of like, you know, questions back, is just simply the authorities haven't got enough people in their, you know, in their buildings to basically approve this. And we have had Easter in between, which people could be going on holiday, I don't know, going down to Cornwall or Devon, and so you've had a shortage of people. Or alternatively, you know, basically, they haven't been able to finish off the test as quickly because there's been a lot, you know, sort of like less infectious, or a mix of the two, I don't know. But all I would say for investors is, my view, don't get worried.
Even now, there's always delays. You know, I mean, every time, I remember once having a timeline of about 10 companies with milestones coming up, and they, you know, they'd all said we're having it by this time. Whenever you get other parties involved or government bodies involved, there's always delays. I mean, delays. I mean, you know, that's the trouble. Yeah, don't get panicky about delays. I mean,
but a lot of people are, and that's why I wanted to make the point that my view as an investor, I really don't know what's happening in terms of the, you know, am I in the same position as absolutely everybody else? Is this is just normal business as usual? Something is just, it's an admin thing. It's a lack of resource in the authorities, or alternatively, they took a slightly longer to finish the clinical trial test.
So when did they say the deadline was?
It was going to be sometime the start of April. Well, now we're on the 9th, and a lot of people are getting a bit nervous. And we've had Easter in between, crikey! So I bet you people are on holiday, you know. Now the other big healthcare.
So, look at the chart, though. I mean, like I said, they had a dip down. Look at the chart, and it's up testing previous highs. So the chart speaks the truth.
It says to me, well, there was people were getting worried, so I just wanted to make the point that, you know, and I know it's a well sort of like followed stock. Another one on the healthcare that is worth talking about, and we chatted about it 2 weeks ago, is Oncimmune. Now, those shares have done really well. And I said to you last time that I was trying to catch up with the CEO, Adam Hill, and I managed to on a video. And I would recommend anybody who's interested in this, the next generation immunodiagnostics firm, absolutely fabulous technology in auto antibodies, okay, with all their biobank of over 8,000 sort of, you know, proteins. And they can do services through their immuno insights, and they can do products like their lead product, which is a lung cancer nodule test to early screen people. Now, I alerted you 2 weeks ago that something which really crossed my desk when I had a look at it was one of their partners in the US got a company, a billion-dollar business called Biodizix, had made a combo test for early lung cancer by using Oncimmune's early CD test to do super high specificity, and their test to do super high sensitivity, giving them a well-balanced test. And effectively, from my limited knowledge, it's absolute breakthrough. We've got 98% specificity and 97% sensitivity. And surprise, surprise, Biodizix are increasing their sales force out in the States. And if anybody's interested in this, I say it's a next generation immunodiagnostic. Have a look at that video. And about 19 and a half minutes in, I ask Adam in terms of, you know, what the progress is out in the States. And my view, reading between the lines, is he's absolutely delighted. I actually, you know, I cheekily asked him. He didn't answer, but I cheekily asked him whether he could bring the test over the UK, over to the UK, that combo test, because frankly, you know, the world could really do with it in the UK, because it could literally save, you know, tens of thousands of lives worldwide. And this is a massive market in the US. I hadn't appreciated. As I say, if investors are seriously interested, yeah, they've got an investor presentation. Here it is, right? And it's about if a good benchmark of if something works, yeah, they put it in their investor presentation. There's Oncimmune's early CD test, and it's actually rebranded, it's called Nodify CDT-Z test, yeah? Hasn't just got one page, it's got six pages in the investor presentation.
Oh, they love that.
They absolutely believe in it. And all I would say is that this could be an absolute, I mean, I hadn't seen it, it came through left field, but I think this could be an absolute home run for them. And anyway, if people are interested, have a look at it. And I think that's the reason why people have started to actually, the shares have gone up after that video was released with Adam, because people realize this is a massive market. There's 4 or 5 million tests for early cancer, and that's just a start, each year in the US. If you've got a better test, there'll be even more. The industry is worth over $20 billion just on cancer screening and cancer testing. It could be enormous. And then you can sort of like, you know, just lift and shift it to other parts of the world where biotech. So I think that could be a knockout product. Now, the other news they had was but they signed, I mean, another fabulous endorsements was their infectious disease panel for COVID, which they've been developing, the government. They've carried on developing it on their own back. And they've basically sold it for research purposes, that infectious disease panel, to Cedars-Sinai and Roche, two world-leading businesses in diagnostics. So it just says to me, their technology, it works brilliant. Not just well, it works brilliantly. The best-in-class diagnostics companies can't actually replicate it themselves in-house and need, you know, Oncimmune to do it for them. So again, you know, people
let me just point out as well, you know, for clarity and transparency there, that Paul Hill and Dr. Adam Hill are not related. He's not pushing his brother's business. I was going to say, family business doing very well. Now the share price is doing excellent.
Not relatives. We're not brothers or siblings or anything like
and
that.
And also, let me just point out, when I talk about sort of COVID testing companies, I'm not talking about the companies that we mentioned there. I'm talking about I've seen lots of microcaps trying to jump on the bandwagon of COVID testing, and their share price has benefited. And I think, well, hang on, that's all you've got. You've just jumped on that in the last few months. And I'm talking about, you know, the Avactas of the world, or SourceBios, you know, and the people you've just talked about, because they've got businesses, you know, going on there other than that. But I just see some scrupulous, unscrupulous sort of AIM CEOs, microcaps that use the COVID testing thing to just get their share price up, you know, and pretty much they do a placing off the back of it. And I think that's bad. You know, you're not an expert in the testing field by any means. There are companies out there that are, like, you know, the Avactas and the SourceBios. And the other
interesting, just on this healthcare stuff, the other interesting diagnostics company reporting next week along with SourceBio, okay, and you're interviewing them, I think, which is their CEO, Sarah Barrington, is Verici DX. And the reason why I say that's on Wednesday, I think it is, and the reason why I alert investors is because there was an article on the BBC website today, which basically was saying that because of COVID and long COVID, there is now increasing transplants requirements for transplants of lungs. Now, their specialism is transplants in kidneys, but in long term, there's no reason why, and they've already got it on their map, to do livers and potentially a transplant for diagnostics for livers and heart, and also, you know, possibly lungs. So all I would say, and the reason why I raise it, and maybe a question you want to ask, sort of like long term, is that can we lift this leading technology that they've used from Mount Sinai, from kidney transplants into these other organs that, frankly, because what thing has happened in terms of long COVID? I mean, there's a million people in the UK suffering from long COVID, of which, unfortunately, 120,000 are in the NHS. And what's happened there is that people's organs have been permanently damaged, meaning going forward, the number of transplants in the world that require, are required by people, it's going to just explode. So you're going to need these guys. You know, Verici could be push the clock back, forward 5 years in an absolute sweet spot, because the market for transplants has just exploded. It really has, because people from COVID have got permanent damage to their vital organs, kidneys, hearts, lungs. Yeah. And so, you know, it's something to have a chat to. But
do you know what? Talking about that, and it's related, I own a company called Polarean, you know, and they've got phase 3 clinical trials past them. Their FDA approval date's come up in October. And it's in my mind, and in fact, if you look at their stuff, it's almost like a box-ticking exercise for the FDA. I think it'll be no problem commercializing this. And I had Richard, the CEO, on the podcast, and he said in America, their market due to COVID is increased by 50%.
Yeah,
that's how big the market has gone up, because they're primary sort of diagnostics. They're hyperpolarized xenon gas, which is not harmful, and the other comparators out there are harmful, radiation, all that stuff. And the images they get is up to 100,000 times better. And so it's no brainer really, but they can really pick up on, you know, really areas of the lungs being affected by COVID. And so if you go to their presentation, actually, they do images of COVID-affected lungs. And it's amazing. I mean, the market is just, it's a massive market anyway. I think America, $150 billion they spend on lungs and all that kind of stuff in every year. And now it's increased by 50%. So,
I think that's conservative. I could see it doubling, easy. Simply because the amount of people, you'll only find out in a year of what the serious long-term consequences of this. And it will carry on as well, because we'll still get these variants. So, no, I'm with you. The other
sort of... Do you ever have a company? I mean, I've been in players, but I've held it the longest now. I've probably had it for a couple of years. And,
I thought you said a couple of days.
Yeah. And a couple of years I've had it. And it's almost like, you know, it's one
which
of the...
Which company?
Polarean.
Oh, sorry, you know, Polarean.
POLX is ticker there, Polarean Imogen. And... you know, and from the start, even before COVID came along, you thought, well, the existing technology out there is so inferior to what they have. And you look at the big guys in there with them, you know, people, the big shareholders, they're also very experienced in the industry. So you think, wow, that's a big... They've just had a fundraise, of course, $25 million, very little discount. And they've already got 23 machines in sort of research use out there already. But you look at that and you think sometimes, and I hate to say the word no-brainer, but you see it when you research it, you think, well, I don't understand where this can go wrong. And obviously, there's risks with every... And I've had people say to me, actually, investors say, what's the risk of the FDA turning it down? And with investing, there's always a risk. Of course it is. There's left-field risk you don't see. There's always a risk. But it's just a case of how small is that risk or how big is the risk? You can actually evaluate, you know, because there are risks out there you can't evaluate. But if you can, and that's why investing sometimes, it's always good to look at the risk side of it. Because if you can evaluate that side, there's always reward pretty much in developing companies. But a lot of people go into it just looking at the reward potential without looking at the risk. And I said this, one person who said this to me, there's always risk. No matter how small, there's always risk. So before, because I can see the thought process of this person thinking, I'm going to put all my money into the stock because I see it's going to be a £1 billion company and yet I don't see any risk, but there's always risk. So before you chuck everything into a company, and it may seem like a no-brainer, no investment is a no-brainer. No investment, you know?
You sound to me like a value investor there, Justin. You sound sensible.
Polarean has been like that. And I've had times where I thought, because I've looked around and had other investments, you know, and a few of them I've got huge conviction on. Polarian's been that one that I have a huge conviction on. And at the start, I thought, should I just chuck all my money in Polarean and just let it go? Because I think it's going to be a £1 billion company. But you always will realize there's always risk. Because that's why you must diversify a little bit, you know.
Yes, exactly,
in fact, that guy on Twitter this week, and he said he had so many stocks. And I don't know how much money he's managing. He said, I see myself as a fund. You shouldn't see yourself as a fund because you haven't got the same dealing costs. You haven't got research companies. You can't do the same amount of work as funds can do. If you want to diversify, I suggest you buy a fund. It's a lot cheaper in the long term. A good fund will get you a good return. And then you focus on a few stocks that you can do some research on. Because if you're working a normal job, you haven't got time. Like investment companies, research companies, you are working, whatever you're doing 9 to 5, they are doing that, researching 9 to 5, you know, fund companies. So buy a fund if you want diversification. But if you want, you know, decent reward, you've got to focus a little bit and have a bit of conviction, you know, on some stocks, not lots of stocks. Because like I said, diversification protects you against risk, but also against reward, you know. And so I just think you shouldn't see yourself as a fund and hold hundreds of companies. It's not efficient. You haven't got the resources that they've got, you know.
Just a bit of experience on your question about FDA now, approvals, okay?
Yeah.
For my 20, 30 years of experience, the FDA, okay, don't always approve a product, even if it's the best technology, because they get lobbied heavily by US incumbents who would be damaged by the introduction of a new product. And through that political and lobbying process, sometimes the world's best product doesn't get approved by the FDA. Nobody will ever tell you that, and nobody will ever admit to it. But I've seen that happen too often, that a local US manufacturer gets first dibs, even though their technology is inferior.
Yeah, exactly. Well, two bits on that. First of all, there's a risk there people don't see, maybe. And secondly, these are additive, accretive to MRI scanners. The big companies that produce these MRI scanners, it's adaptable to all those, and it brings the cost of using them. They'll be used more, so it's better for those companies as well. So they're already in the hospitals, you know. Mm. So I can't see much competition because it's not going to replace. I mean, you know, it's not going to replace a lot. It's just additive to the tech that's there, you know.
Yeah. The other one, and I keep banging the table. I'm moving on, okay? Because yeah. we're on healthcare and we've covered that one, yeah. With technology, yeah, fintech. Did you see Equals' prelims yesterday?
And there was I did. I scanned through. I looked at the chart afterwards, see what happens and all that stuff, and see what happens. I didn't have a lot of time, give me your thoughts.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Now, yesterday I had a number of questions from investors. They were basically saying, look, the current run rate for the business in Q1 has been fabulous. We're back to pre-pandemic levels in terms of turnover. They hit £8 million of turnover in...
Almost 8% up today. Almost.
Yeah, no, exactly. So I've had some questions on this, okay? So I just want to try and explain it to investors, right? Yesterday, they came out with a very resilient... 2020 results. Their 2021 Q1 results were much better than my expectations, how I modeled it, and the markets. Okay. And they indicated that they did £8 million of turnover in Q1. That is in the midst of a hard lockdown. Fabulous results. You would have expected yesterday the shares to have really appreciated. And this is the question. People scratching their head and saying, what frankly happened, yesterday? Well, I'll tell you what happened. There was lots and lots of people buying, but somebody basically placed a large block of shares, which were only reported after hours yesterday, 6:30, just before it closed. And that's what sort of took the stock down. Now, once that person has removed or stopped selling, these shares are going to go up. And I think that's what's happened today. In terms of those buyers are basically just lapping it up. And that's why the shares have increased by 8 or 10% today. And I could see them going up a lot more because, I mean, I've increased my estimates, for full year because I only had sort of like just over 32 million full year. And if you times 8 by 4, you get 32. And they're going to grow. The second half is going to be fabulous in my view. And the government's going to chuck in some more jungle juice. We're going to be doing, you know, help me party anywhere type schemes, which is going to allow corporates and people to go out and enjoy themselves. And these guys are going to be perfectly placed with all their e-payments and fintech and Forex and all kinds of stuff that they do for B2B businesses. So I've increased my, I've only ticked it up, but I think my estimate for revenue is about 33.4. I think that's modest. And I've put up my fair value on the stock to 70p compared to now about 41, 42p. But frankly, I can see them blowing through that. As I say, the government is absolutely committed by going to do, you know, sort of putting some more stimulus into the market in terms of helping businesses. And they're going to be a perfect beneficiary of it. And what was quite interesting, what's driven the Q1 outperformance has been March, because as we're vaccinated, more business optimism has gone through the roof. Yeah, which has been great. Sterling has increased because the economy is looking in a better place, which has meant that people are now spending more pounds to buy abroad, and therefore, because it goes further, and bringing product in, so that was helping. And then interestingly, and this was a bit of anecdotal evidence, it was from the interview with Richard Cooper, the CFO. He says he's been going past a lot of film crews who have been shooting on location because they can now. And what's happened is that's led to a big rise in their corporate expenses, as in like, you know, they're at the help, what they help with people paying for domestic corporate expenses in sterling. So this could really fly this year. It's well positioned. It's cashed up. It's got plenty. It's got 8 million of net cash. Technology is great. The B2B to SME customers is going fabulously well. And they've still got 5 million, roughly, of turnover that hasn't come back just because we haven't been able to travel abroad or go, you know, business people or holiday people. This, in my view, this could hit over 40 million of turnover, you know, in 2022, because the economy is going to go gangbuster when we open up. And then I cheekily asked Ian Stratford Taylor, the CEO, at the end, you know, I had 50 million of just over 50 million of turnover for 2025. And I just said, look, you know, what do you think? And he said, well, actually, I'll be disappointed if we don't do that. Now, if you did a 5x multiple on 50 to get 250, yeah, well, basically, I've got 53 now because I've had to tick it up. You get a price of over £1.30, £1.50. You know, if you're prepared to wait for 4 years, frankly, I'm a long-term investor. I don't care. So I think this has got a real following tailwind. And I would alert people. Have a look at the video. Ian and Richard were optimistic. And the exact words in quotes were highly enthused. So this is looking good. And we've reached the bottom. We're moving forward. The only thing that's been depressing the shares, which happened yesterday, is you've got people basically just dropping some shares into the market, which is fine because long term it's going up, in my view.
Yeah. No, do you know what? That happened, frustratingly, that happened to one of my stocks this week. And there's a lot of warrants in Gfinity, there's eSports. They announced an extended partnership with Venatus, which is this ad tech company. Yeah. And it's very good, you know, it's extended groups. And the guy at Venatus said, you know, he bigged up. He said, we're excited to expand our global relationship with Gfinity as a sole monetizer. And they said, you know, a huge asset in the eSports community, Gfinity, and it's a good thing. And yet, for some reason, the share price didn't do anything, wasn't going anywhere with it. Mm. I was like, what's going on here?
Yeah.
And then, yeah, late after trade on that day, you saw a big block trade go through, and that's what held it back. And
it was what you said, was it 2 weeks ago? Don't get worried, but you know, but if people sell, but they sell for various reasons, maybe take a bit of profits, generate a bit of cash, and whatever like that. So, you know, don't get too worried by it.
Yeah, exactly. If the story's the same, you know, just stick with it a little bit. Gfinity of all shares is so frustrating. The new CEO came in last year, decided to say, right, we're going to make this company a profitable company because it's been in a hot area of esports. They've had people, investors throwing money at them. They've just gone through it and burned through lots of cash and done, you know, they've had some good relationships with big brand names, but not really generated any real cash. And then John came on the podcast, on the board, and he said three times on the podcast before I even believed it, he said, I'm turning this round. I've got three pillars that I'm focusing on. And two of them just been newly created and now flying. And he said, we're aiming for profitability. But they had to, at the low end of the share price, when they're in lowest sentiment, when the legacy management was still there, they found it hard to raise money because it burned through so much cash. All the, you know, the investors they relied on pretty much said, no, listen, we've had enough of this now. The share price is going down and you're burning it. You've been burning it for years. And so they had to sort of throw in these one-for-one warrants, you know. So they raised like 2.25 million down here and had to throw in one-for-one warrants. And they've been plaguing the share price. Every time there's a rise or a bit of liquidity, these warrant holders just, you know, dumping their shares, which is so frustrating. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the revenue is building. And in fact, in the most important parts, Gfinity Digital Media, which is like got margins above 70% of what they own. And they really just started last year. It's going to have 2 million in revenue this year. Mm-hmm. And it's growing very quickly. You know, that there, for example, they're going in the right direction and the revenue is growing. But yet, every time that somebody good news comes out, you know, these legacy holders are dumping shares, which is very frustrating. But you realize in time that will not happen. The expiration on these warrants are like in October. And so that'll stop happening. And the business will just, again, you know, at the end of the day, is the business improving? Will it be in a better place in 12 months, 3 years, 5 years? If it will, hold on. You can't deal with, you know, warrant holders or technicalities of day-to-day share prices. All you can look at is the long-term trend, isn't it, really?
Yeah, absolutely. And I could see, you know, with Gfinity, if the carries on with the fundamentals going, these things pop vertically very quickly once you've got rid of those overhangs, because the fundamentals are so powerful that it just drives the revaluation very quickly. And that happens often in sort of small caps or AIM stocks, simply because... Yeah. You know,
so you see what happens as well. Selling begets selling sometimes. You know, when someone's held a stock for a while and they're frustrated in the share price, you have good news and the share price goes down. Someone just jump anyway. You think, well, I can't be bothered anymore. And so it just extends the frustration. But like, so sooner or later, you say, you're right. And I said that in my video. Sooner or later, one of the sellers will go, the big seller will go, it'll dry up the selling and the operations will continue to churn out good news and the buyers just pick up. And all it's about at the end of the day is buying versus selling. That's all share price is about, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's more buyers and sellers, the share price goes
up. I mean, it's that classic Warren Buffett. It's a voting machine in the short term, the stock market, and then a weighing machine in the long term, isn't it?
And, in fact, today, I'll really say one thing that's always frustrating, the share price. I had Jason Tebb, the new CEO of OnTheMarket. He's on the podcast. And it's very nice that he comes from the industry. I assumed that when you're setting up a property portal, you'd have people from the industry. But no, he was from an estate agent. He said, I've witnessed the growth and prop tech, as it's called, coming online. I was an estate agent years ago. I know all about it. And he's been doing these sort of virtual town hall meetings with all the agents. And he's got lots of feedback. And again, he's got a four-pillar strategy putting in place. And he's very optimistic. And he said, listen, I don't understand why the share price has done what it's done recently. But the business is improving. You know, we've grown from 18 to 23 million in the last year. And that was during COVID year when we've given discounts to people. And if you compare the Rightmove didn't grow last year. They went down last year, you know. So, again, it's one of those things where the business is improving, but the share price is frustrating, you know. Yeah. And sometimes people sell because of that. You think, no, all you can do is, you can't control the share price. All you can do is focus on the business, really, isn't it, you know?
Do you still own OnTheMarket?
Yeah, I still own it. But it's just frustrating because it's very illiquid and a couple of sales each day will move it down. And then other people will start selling because it's frustrating, no news. And Jason, apparently, he's had a policy of not doing any news for the first 100 days. He wants to, you know, get some initiatives going first and put his,
What's the share price of it now? It's about 90p.
Let's have a look. Yeah, no, it's come back down. It's come down 90 there, 90 pence. So it's gone up. You know, a big bound, anything from that March dash for gas. That was the time to get in on any stock we know now. Fear is your friend. Get in on the fear. And just went down to 30 pence there. But it went up to 140, touched that, and it's come back down to 90 pence now. But again, all it's been is dribbles of sales, really, a couple of buys, but there's been
What I like about talking to you, Justin, you come up with some good ideas, because I think this is a fabulous company, and I haven't got any cash at the moment, spare cash. Mm. It's all in long-term holdings. But I would say that is right up there. If that comes, I mean, at 80, 90p, it's a steal.
Well, they are 2.6 times revenue now, and they made a profit last year. They got 10 million in cash. They're growing, you know, so.
And that's trailing revenue, isn't it? That's trailing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and it doesn't take a lot. Very interesting. They've exercised this call option on Glanty, which is Techlet, which is this automated cloud-based system that'll take 80% of the work off agencies, and people can sort of tenancy agreements any time of the day, 24 hours a day, you know. And he said to me, all we need this is, it takes 80% of the work off agencies. And if we even increase average revenue per advertiser by £100, it's significant, because their average at the moment is 133 quid a month. Now, that's compared to Rightmove, which is close to 1,000. And so that you combine that with also bringing on some of the agents who are on discounted contracts or free contracts. And then you could do like 40 million easy within a year. And if they do that, and
what's the marginal profit for OnTheMarket of selling Glanty's software?
I have no idea.
It must be 90% plus, isn't it?
Exactly.
Selling air.
Exactly, because it's all, you know, all the money's gone into it now. It's been invested into. That's the money already in there. Yeah. And exactly, it was like you say, software. It's copy and paste.
Perfect.
So the margin's very good. And like he did say, he says it's not going to be all about the property portal. That's our core, yes. But now essentially Glanty's a software house. And we can.
Well, I would alert investors. That's right. Going to be right up on my watch list. OnTheMarket from now on. It's coming to just like super value territory for somebody like me.
Well, I don't know if you look at this, but look at this down here upon the chart. Right, this is something called the relative strength index. This is 30. It goes from 0 to 100. That's 30. Normally known as oversold. That's 70 overbought. You know, when it goes up there, it's quite strong. This price is quite weak down here. But it's down here at the moment. It jumped today. I think some people have pre-heard because the interview's out there, but it's not in the podcast yet. But some heard that. People have had feedback saying, I like him, actually. He's clear. He's concise. He's from the industry. Mm. And he knows what he's doing. He's got a plan and a vision.
They've still got Clive Beattie there, haven't they?
Oh, yeah, no, Clive. When I recorded it, Clive was on the call, but he's quiet. Clive is excellent. You know, Clive is a CFO, and exactly. And I think it's very good also for a CFO to be in a CEO's position, then, you know, then be the CFO again, and give that support to the CEO. You know, I think it's a very good thing to have. So, yeah.
I've interviewed Clive before, and frankly, he's top drawer. And what particularly about Clive, he's growth orientated, and he's prepared to take calculated risks with money, which is absolutely perfect. And this is what they need. So him and Jason could make a perfect sort of tag team here.
Yeah. And I don't know if Right Move's the main dog, but I did have a comparison sheet somewhere when you see like Right Move is something now about 75 times the value of On the Market. Mm. But if you look at any other metric, it's really odd. It's like it doesn't stack up. Even the traffic visits, site visits, you know, bookings through agents, all that kind of stuff, doesn't stack up anywhere near that, of course, because they are profitable. But I think Right Move about 25 times revenue. Mm. On the Market is 2.5 times revenue, close to. So it's like, you know, there's room there for a bit of movement up, you know. So yeah. And they've got to get it's going right
there. Another one on the software front was reported last week that I own. It's actually my largest position at the moment because the shares have appreciated. Is Eleco. It used to be called Eleco Soft, Build Tech Software.
Yeah.
And they put out
a tear. Look at that.
I know. Yeah. I know. And I've been rabbited on about this for certain time. Yeah. I know I've owned it for certain, you know. I know you've owned it in the past as well, haven't you? And then you sort of got a bit bored and stuff. But what's happened now is that the last piece in that they're profitable, they're cash generative, they're very tightly and well run. The last piece of the jigsaw is turbocharging their top line organic growth. Okay, and the news that happened when they produced their prelims was, not only did they come through COVID with a higher profit level on a largely flat revenue, i.e. a tremendous result, and cash increased by 5 million from 1 million to 6 million, so leaving them about just over 6 million pounds of net cash at the end of the year. But the big, big news, like Equals, is that they've had a really good start to the year, Eleco. Their organic growth for the first 2 months to the end, for year to date, to the end of February, was 4%, okay? During a lockdown, compared to comparatives last year in 2020, which was pre-COVID and was a gangbuster for them. So to be 4% up on a gangbuster period from 2020 is a fabulous result. And that's what's turbocharged the shares of late. People now see this is the last piece of the jigsaw. And just to give you an indication, it's like Equals, for instance, is valued at less than 2x sales, okay? Their competitors, their closest competitor is Alpha FX, which is valued at 9x sales. Well, these guys are in the same boat. Eleco is valued at now, even at £1.15, is valued at less than 3.5x sales. I think it's 3.4 if you run the numbers, yeah? But their competitors, NememsCheck, Autodesk, and Bentley Systems are all on 8, 9, 10x sales. And if these guys can grow at the same rate as the industry or all their biggest competitors, then this is going to absolutely, this could go over £2, no doubt about it. That'd be my view. And what it's got, is got Jonathan Hunter, the CEO, with the exec chairman, Serena Lang, who are doing a fabulous job. They're just basically pushed out a new strategy, spent a long time becoming far more customer-centric. They're going to invest heavily in the States. And surprise, surprise, Biden is trying to put a $2 trillion infrastructure bill, which is obviously going to put an extra rocket booster behind that whole industry. But one thing which has happened in the industry, in construction industry, in the house building industry, is that they now realize because of COVID, they have to digitize. Who are in the box seat to be able to do this? Eleco. They couldn't have a bigger tailwind. So yes, people say, God, the shares have gone up, but frankly, it's dropping the ocean, absolute drop in the ocean. So yeah. I've not sold a single share. I'm not going to sell a single share because they're in a great position. Why do you want to? Effectively, this is a winning horse. This is Shergar, in the race, It's a dead cert favorite. And you've got lots of sort of like, there's big prizes at the end of it. Why do you want to start messing around with this? And, I like the management team, love the business. And this last piece of the jigsaw, the organic growth. I mean, again, I've uplifted my forecasts for this year. I could see them blowing through those. I could like Equals. I don't know, because, who knows? But if I was a betting man, I would say I'm going to be upgrading going forward. And I just gut feel. I don't want to get too positive about all these stocks, but frankly, you know, I think I am, because I can see the economy reopening, digitization happening, infrastructure spend. These guys, like Equals, are going to do really well.
Yeah. I mean, at the moment, I've got a little bit of cash. I'm looking around. I'm just going to be very patient because at the moment I feel like...
What have you sold, what have you sold to have a bit of cash?
Just a couple of stocks I was dabbling with. I haven't really ever mentioned with. I'm not convinced.
Go on, spill the beans.
My problem is, right, I get everyone, I suppose. You get too excited by stocks.
Just caveat it.
Because I haven't got them anymore. So some people may still hold them. The only thing I'll do by saying I've sold them is annoy people who still hold them. So there's no point. So I could be wrong. I've been wrong several times before. I jumped out of stocks. And they've been amazingly wrong on one stock. A couple of stocks. I'll tell you about one stock. I jumped out of a company called Argo Blockchain Mining, right?
Yeah, I know.
I have a 20% up. It's now 3,000% up. So,
purposes, Justin. I would tell people. I mean, don't on this podcast, on this video cast. But at some point, just tell people. And the reason is because you sell and I sell and everybody sells in the business. You don't just always hold. And you tell
people personally ask me, right? I mean, you know, in a one-on-one situation, I will say, and I'll tell them, but I won't broadcast it. And that is something he said. So I will say, but I won't broadcast it. But no, the thing is, and I'm looking for a company. I'm going to be very, and I'm determined to be very patient. I'm looking for a microcap, looking for something scalable. I've got several.
I've got one for you, mate.
Hang on a sec, but do you know what came to me? I'm looking at companies, that could be down here. And a lot of companies have rallied of late, just this sentiment of a reopening, you know? And I thought, do you know what? What I want is a correction. And I know one's coming, because they come. We've had a few 5% sell-offs in the last year, and I think we're still going to be volatile with the reopening. It's not going to be a smooth ride straight up like that, you know, or that way for you. So, you know, but I mean, so I think sometimes you should look at, you know, sell-offs as opportunities. So they are. If you look at like that dash for cash, everything there, you know, let's be honest, you can tell Eleco, for example, you know, has had a good year. Then it's gone down a little bit, tiny bit. In the worst year ever, pandemic year's revenue, hardly anything. But everything else has gone up on the recurring revenues, operating profit before tax. It's all gone up, you know, free cash flow. So it's a very decent company. So sometimes you can't get them cheaply. You've got to just pay the price, or you wait for a correction, you know, and sometimes they take a dip. And that's when there's opportunity. So corrections are opportunities. They're not to be scared of, because the market always bounces back. We know that. But you've got to have a bit of patience. Wait for that correction. Jump into the stock you've been waiting for. And then you get that little bit of advantage, you know, on the market. Who's that person that sometimes the market comes to you with different prices every day? And the Mr. Market or Mrs. Market is a bit mad. Sometimes they're really bullish, sometimes they're really bearish. Just got to wait for the bearish days, you know, and take the price off them that they don't want to sell at, but you want to buy at, you know. And
that happens. I'll give you two potential triggers for a sell-off this year, okay?
Yeah.
One is well talked about, is if Joe Biden gets his tax increase bill through to lift it from 21% corporation tax to 28% or even higher, okay? That would definitely be a negative on the market in the US and would be negative elsewhere. But most people sort of like factored in that, considered it as low risk. Okay, but that would definitely be a negative. The other one, which is not priced in my view, and we've discussed it at the start of this, you get a nasty variant coming, doing the rounds, and it stops the reopening in emerging markets or even in Western Europe. Or alternatively, we reopen and we get something that really reduces the efficacy even of tweaked vaccines in the autumn. We get something like that, then you're going to see a sell-off because people will think, oh my God, here we go again, you know. So I'm with you.
I guarantee it'll be neither of those because we know about them.
No, the second one.
I guarantee there'd be no really bad. I mean, Brazil, their vaccinations the program isn't that good at the moment. Honestly, I guarantee there will not be a variant now that will shake the market as previously, because we know about the variants.
Not shake the market as previously. Don't get me. I'm not saying. No,
but I don't think it will, because we know about the variants, and most of the world won't be affected by them. because we're vaccine and they prevent severe disease anyway. I think it just sometimes it goes out of left field, these sell-offs, and it's connected to something that we don't know yet. You know, that always happens, doesn't it? You know, like we could have predicted really that sell-off was going to happen when we announced we're going to lock down the economies, but we didn't see it coming that big, you know, and fast. But so we didn't really, it's always something we don't really see, you know, you just got to sit and wait for it. Sometimes it's something ridiculous.
Yeah,
it
could be Kim. Yeah,
it could be Kim Jong Un, just you know, test a new nuclear weapon or something, or anything, you know, from China or in fact, when was the last one from the Far East that happened years back, and no one ever saw one of the currencies going ballistic.
Well, there was Russia, wasn't it, in the nineties, which had that Asian crisis.
Yeah. Something left field sometimes that comes from it. Maybe COVID related, but yeah. one thing you can guarantee, you can have a correction pretty much every 18 months. Yeah. You know,
if you're looking for a stock that's had a little sell off, okay, that yeah. I think is going purposely primed, and I know we've talked about it, and you bought it at the time, but I think you've actually sold it now. Is Rosslyn?
Do you know what? It's interesting, actually. Rosslyn's gone, isn't he?
Yes, he has. Roger's decided, basically, to pass the baton to... He's the guy he recruited, actually, the
Paul.
CEO.
It was a Paul that came in. As a salesman. See, Paul is a salesman, isn't he?
Yeah, he is.
All Paul's are salesmen. And so he came in by the back door.
Wish I was.
Roger recruited him.
He
kicked Roger out.
No, he didn't.
Typical Paul.
He didn't. No, Roger. I mean, basically, you know, Roger's been there for a long time, and he's done a fabulous job in raising money, positioning the company. Again, they've basically got a lot of money in the bank. They've got great customers, excellent software. The last piece of the jigsaw, like Eleco, like Equals, is this effectively accelerating the organic growth? They are super positioned to do well on that. They need somebody to really lead the sales charge. Since Paul Watts, the COO, joined, he has had an immediate impact on boosting the pipeline. And it's converting those pipeline into orders. And, you know, I mean, I give it to Roger's credit. He's basically said, look, you know, this guy's better positioned to lead this business going forward on the sales line. And so Paul's now taken over, being helped by the exec chairman and also being helped by the CFO. But I could see this one absolute rocketing if they can, you know.
It's another one of your stocks rocketing. All your stocks are going to rocket.
I hate to say it. I know.
I love it. That's why I'm in them.
the point is, you know, I said to you.
That's what we're all going for.
I've got all of us. I've got core holdings. Mm. But I'm really reticent to sell any because I think they've got opportunity. How long have I been telling you? I wrote off 2020, but 2021 could be an absolute monster year.
Yeah, but listen, I like the spreadsheet analysis and all that stuff. But it'll save us a lot of time, Paul. Just came on, named your stock and the ticker, and just say it's going to rocket. Okay, just buy that one. Next stock, this one, that's going to rocket. But no, Rosslyn data. Listen, I mean, just look at the chart there. You can see that, right? I've got a price alert on them already. So when the guy announced that director change there, I thought I'm going to put a price alert. If it dips somewhere, yeah, I may have a look at this because you know. I'm looking at it, and you know, I thought
I'm very positive on these guys. And let's be clear about it. It might take the reopening, but we're coming onto the cusp of that now. They've had an inline trading statement. They're in line with market expectations. They've got a free pass for the next few months.
Let me just say, it's a controversial thing. There's a lot of software service companies out there. I know they get, you know, a higher multiple because they, you know, consistent revenue turnover. The thing I kept saying with Rosling, and they needed growth, you know, and they put this guy Paul in. I know you were bullish before, but now Paul's at the helm. There's a Paul at the helm. I'm definitely bullish. It's going to rocket. But what I'm saying is, discuss quickly, because we've been on a long time now. Sorry. If a company is successful and growing, why do they need to acquire other companies? If their proposition is the best, do they need to acquire?
Why do they need to acquire?
If they've got organic growth, they don't need to, do they?
No, of course. It depends. Comes down to opportunity. If they can increase their addressable market, okay. I mean, it's like Amazon, okay. Why the flipping hell did it basically?
They got massive anyway. They were massive. Now they've got, when you get to, but that's it. When you get a certain level, you can't keep growing. Even though Amazon are.
So you just answered your question.
You've got to acquire new tech and stuff. But if you're in demand, we saw from Rosslyn, they didn't have growth. That's the thing. They had everything there, but not growth. And that's what they hired, a salesman, didn't they? Paul. Trust the Paul. Put your faith in Paul.
But I mean, you just answered your question to increase your addressable market, to improve your solution. You know,
as a small company, you should be a fast grower anyway. That's what I'm saying. As a big company, of course, your growth is going to stumble. You're going to slow down. And that's why you look for acquisitions to bolster that growth, because you can't keep growing.
Einstein, right?
Small companies should be growers, shouldn't they?
Einstein, yeah. You've got a really, really good product, right?
You're struggling.
Let's just say you've got a really, really good product, you know, hypothetically, right? If you add another really good product to it, you don't just do one and one is two, you get five off the back of it. It becomes a world beater.
But hang on, if you're a small company with limited resources and you've got a very good product and the sales are going out the door and you're growing very quickly, you don't think, let's get another good product. You don't need to. You've got so much demand for your product. You don't need to. Let's get another product in.
Let's say you buy that for one, whatever one is, right? And the value you generate from it is 100 off the back of it. Would you say, oh, right, I won't buy it, even though the upside's 100 times? I mean,
let's agree here. What's the problem at the start? They had a nice, it was ticking along, but there was no big growth. That was the issue, wasn't it? And that's why they got Paul in.
Paul
Paul will always save the day. Okay. Just hire a Paul.
We're both on the same page. They need to grow.
Yeah, we all like Paul.
And that's what they need to do. They need to basically, turbocharge that, that growth. The last bit of the jigsaw, just very, very quickly, is, and you love it, I know, because I own it, is Sage, right? And I've had a couple of investors, I know, don't laugh, I've had a couple of investors say, you haven't actually mentioned Sage. Now, they've actually started to increase.
Because it's boring.
I like boring stocks that start to increase.
And it's got no Paul in it.
And if you do all your modelling, all those flipping lines, I don't know what they mean anyway. But
they're moving averages. Exactly. You should like that. That's based on prices, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not messing around. That's basically an average.
What's that saying to you now? It's saying
that's saying right now. I said last time. Look at that. That's hit 200-day moving average. Yeah. That means the price has been rising pretty much for the majority of those last 200 days, or the last. That's why the price is starting to hit that. So that's good. That's good momentum there. You know,
and that tells me, their core software is selling well, and their key customers into small, medium-sized businesses, which is their bread and butter sort of stuff, are starting to digitize their back offices. Okay. Which equally makes a lot of benefit for Equals as well, and for a digitization of Eleco, and for Rosslyn. So all I'm saying is that we've had the front office digitization of businesses and corporates, and I know I've been talking about this, I found like a broken record, still get battered around though, is the back office needs to be digitized. And this is what these guys do perfectly. This is saying, who knows? But that's saying to me, you're starting to see green shoots. If they increase their organic growth, you're going to see the share go well above £10, in my view. And it's a big cap, it's safe, it pays a nice dividend, it's got a really rock-solid balance sheet. It's a no-brainer, it's like Astra.
Oh, it's a no-brainer, it's going to rock it.
Okay, yeah, it won't rock it, but it could do. It's a large cap I'm willing to hold for years, and I think that's going to do well. But I know I've had a lot of investors asking me about Sage, and I think it's just a long-term holding. I want to keep in my portfolio.
Yeah, and do they have a Paul on the board?
No, they don't.
That's where get that last piece of the jigsaw in there.
But I do know personally.
They will rock it.
But I do know personally, the chief marketing officer who is on the board, a lady called Kath Kears, I used to work for her. She is super. She did a brilliant job for O2. I think she's going to do the same thing on the marketing side for Sage, and she's already been doing it. I'm sure she's one of the main reasons why they're going to do well. But she's top draw, Kath Kears.
Sage SGE is ticker there, and that's not the board of directors. They're bound to.
She's on the leadership team. She's not on the board. She's on the leadership team. She's in the executive leadership team.
Okay.
She's the marketing director.
got a Steve's. Steve is always good. They've got a John, always running a John, a couple of Johns, Annette.
You've got, that's the board, that is. You've got
Derek. Yeah. But this,
they're on the, she's on the exec team.
Yeah. Wouldn't it be good if you literally said, if any investment rested on whether you had a Paul involved? I didn't know that.
Hey, I remember, you remember 12 months ago, mate, I lost a big lot of money, didn't I? So, you know.
Did you sell a lot?
No, I didn't sell a lot. I just sold a few things, but you know, it's just one of those things. You live in London, don't you? But,
okay.
You know, where is it?
Martha's Catskey is this year.
Keith
there, Kerry, Peter, Nancy, Luke. Go. Paul, there he is.
Must be good. Mark, another Mark.
Managing Director of UK and Ireland.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Must be good.
Now we can safely say that's going to rocket. on that, do your own research, everyone. Thanks for listening. You can catch us on YouTube as well. And we'll speak to you next week. Cheers, Paul.
Yeah, thanks, Justin.
Okay, it's time for the top five most followed companies on Vox Markets in the last 24 hours. They are at five, Shield Therapeutics. At four, Tirupati Graphite. Shield is down 2.79% at 45.25. At four, Tirupati Graphite. Up 3.68% at 98.5. At three, Nuformix, it's up 3.92% to 2.65. At two, Kibo Energy, really, up 5.2% to 0.505. Haven't been there for a while. And at one, UK Oil and Gas Investments, up 15.71% to 0.405. Okay, time for the top five most viewed and read RNSs. At five, Boohoo, update on warehousing. Yeah, that's exciting. At four, Vesarian, 1.93 million strategic investment by Graphene Lab. At three, Arc Minerals, CASA mining update. At two, Open Orphan, launch of disease in motion platform. And at one, Novacyt trading update, in which they say they provide an update where the contract hasn't been renewed by the Department of Health and Social Care. As a result, the share price right now for Novacyt is down, as I'm looking at it, down 30% right now. That's it for the podcast. Thanks for listening. Muchos apreciados.
The Vox Markets Podcast with Justin Waite. Nothing in this podcast is intended as investment advice, and the people in this podcast may hold positions in the stocks they talk about. Do not buy anything based solely on a tip or recommendation. Please do your own research.